Some months ago, the woman who gave birth to me died. The news had no impact. Within seconds of hearing about it, my attention drifted and I forgot all about it. It only crossed my mind again hours later, and in no time at all, I'd forgotten again. After going no contact with her a few years ago, she swiftly drifted into irrelevance. She'd enter my thoughts fleetingly every few months, when she sent her manipulative letters, or when I was informed of some incident by my brother, who for practical reasons remained in low contact with her. But she'd exit my thoughts almost instantly. Her death answered a question I hadn't even been interested enough to ask myself. Would I feel anything when she died? In my past therapy work and in correspondence, many people have shared personal stories about the death of a parent, sibling, partner, or other significant figure who'd been a poisonous presence in their life. Some of them had intense reactions. Some were positive, like relief, liberation, elation. More often, they were complex. There might be a conflicting jumble of emotions, like grief mixed up with anger and guilt, and it would take time to pick apart and resolve. At the other end of the spectrum, some people, like me, felt nothing much. For some of them, their lack of concern became a cause for concern. They wondered, does this make me a bad person? Or even sick? Has some of the poison rubbed off on me? Have I stared too long into the abuse? In fact, there's often a very simple and benign explanation for this lack of emotion towards the deceased. You're over them. It can be a strange, new experience, especially for people who've got it into their heads that the antagonistic individuals or groups from their past will always arouse some of the same old feelings. Emotions serve various functions. They help us process the meaning of incoming information. If the information feels significant, emotions help us absorb it and adjust to it. They motivate us to make any relevant decisions and take any appropriate action. When harmful individuals or groups no longer spark any response in us, it can just mean our brains have determined that they hold no significance for us now. We've recognized that there's no person of interest here. We have nothing to process. No questions to ponder, no issues to resolve, no decisions to make or action to take. We've reached a state of true indifference. The road from emotional chaos to indifference is often full of twists and turns. Certainly was in my case. The wildest bends were all at the very start, but a couple of fair-sized curves cropped up in later life. For me, those twists and turns weren't about her. Fundamentally, she never changed. She was a fixed point with a very limited range of behavior, what I came to call her bag of tricks. The twists and turns were really about me and my responses to that bag of tricks. Some responses led to more distance and detachment from her poison. Others led to more unhealthy engagement and exposure. The direction I moved in usually depended on my readiness or my failure to acknowledge some truth about her. Looking back at my lack of reaction to her demise, I thought I'd perform a kind of autopsy, examining that winding road to indifference. Listing every jaw-dropping incident would take countless hours, so I'll confine myself to just some of my most pivotal experiences growing up in a malignant Cluster B household. For those unfamiliar with it, Cluster B is an umbrella term covering four classifications of personality disorder: antisocial, borderline, histrionic, and narcissistic. Personality disorders involve persistent, distorted patterns of thinking and behaving. In the case of the four Cluster B disorders, these patterns are characterized as dramatic, emotional, unpredictable, and manipulative. The behavior can become intensely destructive, both to the disordered individuals and those around them. Each of the four disorders has its own flavor. In very broad terms, antisocial disorder refers to a pattern of disregarding social rules and violating other people's rights. Borderline disorder can involve extreme emotional dysregulation and a chronically unstable self-image. Histrionic disorder points to a pattern of inappropriate attention-seeking with theatrical, sometimes sexually provocative behavior. Narcissistic disorder relates to exaggerated ideas of superiority, specialness, and entitlement. In practice, the clinical pictures for these disorders are complex, and the distinctions aren't necessarily clear-cut. A person might exhibit narcissistic and histrionic traits. At the extreme end, there can be vast areas of trait overlap. Sometimes, the individual's behavior is so unfiltered that even total strangers can see there's something off. Some people who've grown up with cluster B relatives report that concerns were frequently expressed by others. What's up with your uncle? Why does your dad act so weird? But many cluster B individuals learn to control themselves in public situations, to hide behind a mask of respectability. Strangers might even form an unusually positive impression of them. But people with intimate experience of the individual know it's a performance. And when polite company departs, the mood can soon change. Any pent-up poison can now be released. Masks add extra levels of disconnection from reality. Targets are often split into two opposing and equally perverse roles. On top of being their abuser's private punchbags, they become their public protectors, colluding with the abuser's false faces and keeping all the grubby secrets that might lead to their abuser's downfall. Many people are born, or indoctrinated as adults, into mask-wearing ideological groups that project a false image of benevolence to the public, while privately exhibiting all the same corruption as malignant cluster B individuals, and forcing targets into all the same distorted shapes. The household I was born into was dominated by a mask-wearing narcissist. Even to give her the title mother, which was itself a hollow performance, is absurd to me now. After going no contact a few years ago, I started using more fitting designations. Some of them, like surrogate, reflected her lack of parental contribution. Others, like parasite, reflected her compulsion to feed on people's emotional reactions, which she would constantly try to provoke by stirring up drama. But for me, it's the names that reflect her mask-wearing that resonate most. It was her mask-wearing that allowed her to continue dispensing her poison for so long. On the flip side, her mask-wearing would also ultimately ensure that when I finally cut her loose from my life, it would be permanent, in the stone-cold knowledge that throughout our decades of interactions, I was never, not for one moment, talking to her. And she was never talking to me. For that reason, to me, she is the imposter. Emerson said, "To be yourself in a world that's constantly trying to make you something else is the greatest accomplishment." That sentiment is especially true in malignant cluster B households, where the attempts to erase you are taken to sickening extremes. For those of us who grow up in these environments, between the moment we're born and the time we leave them behind, there's a common sequence of processes we move through. These processes can overlap substantially. When we start a new one, it doesn't mean the previous ones are finished. But the further we move through each of them, the closer we come to resolution. The first process is damage. This is where we take on the harmful effects of the destructive behavior we're exposed to. As young children, in the absence of intervention, there's often very little any of us can do other than endure our mistreatment. Chances are we won't even realize we're being mistreated, because the ones who are doing it are the ones we most trust. As infants, we depend on our parents for survival. In our most vulnerable, defenseless state, we're hardwired to bond with our primary caregivers, who we instinctively trust with our safety and welfare. In healthy families, that trust is honored. Parents understand that their role is to prepare us to live in the world. They encourage the skills and knowledge we need to carve out an independent existence. In malignant families, our trust is exploited by individuals we could call anti-parents. The anti-parent works directly against us, actively sabotaging our development and fostering passivity, timidity, submission, dependence. The goal is to create compliant toys to serve the anti-parent's fantasies. To achieve that, our personalities have to be erased. We're confined to the extremely limited range of responses deemed acceptable by the anti-parent. Responses that fall outside that range are aggressively punished. It's like living on a minefield. In the household I was born into, three of us grew up on this lethal landscape. Me, my twin brother, and one of my half-sisters. Calla was 10 years older than us from the imposter's previous marriage. The imposter called her Lady Muck. She was the original family scapegoat, a dumping ground for scorn and blame. And some of my very earliest memories in life were of Calla being ritually humiliated. A fourth child, Calla's older sister, Joan, went oddly untouched. The imposter allowed Joan to roam free and harass everyone else. Joan's malicious antics became funny family stories, endlessly retold for entertainment. Shielded from accountability, Joan's behavior became gradually more extreme. In later life, I'd learn how close my brother and I came in our first few months to death or life-changing injuries at Joan's hands. This is the infectious nature of anti-parents. The damage comes not just from them, but also from the people they damage. For infants, the constant bombardment they experience in these households can have long-lasting effects on a number of important areas in the developing brain, including systems governing emotion, attention, memory, decision-making, and stress responses. Many of us will assume these effects are just part of who we are. In my own case, hearing my racing pulse hammering in my ears was just part of daily life at the house and the sound I fell asleep to. I didn't know this wasn't normal. Often, when something went wrong in the house, I'd suddenly go numb and fall into an intense, laggy, dreamlike disorientation. These dissociative responses occur when the body shuts down, diverts the blood supply, and releases pain-relieving opioids in preparation for inescapable injury. I knew on a physiological level what was coming. On the psychological side, at a time when most infants are beginning to develop an organized sense of self, my emerging personality was being overwritten with a non-stop torrent of wild accusations from the imposter. As a result, I began life with a sociopathic self-image. I was a compulsive liar, endlessly scheming against people. My mistakes and accidents were acts of deliberate sabotage. If I voiced a different opinion or preference, I was trying to stir up an argument. If I expressed vulnerability or pain, I was faking it. It was like having a monster mask superglued to my face. Convinced of my wretchedness, I experienced intense imposter syndrome whenever I was around people from the outside world who trusted me and believed in my good nature. As great as it felt to be seen this way, in the back of my mind, I'd often be thinking that one day they'd find out what a beast I was. I had no recollection of doing, saying, or thinking the horrible things I was accused of, but the imposter's ironclad certainty of my guilt made me doubt my own mind. She'd tell me, "I can see right through you." And I came to believe there must be a secret, wicked side to me that was invisible to me, but that she could perceive very clearly. Faced with endless false accusations, I'd constantly question my memory, my senses, my judgment, eventually my sanity. I began to fixate on depictions of madness in films and TV. Was I insane? Did I have split personality? Even multiple personalities? At the age of 7, when my classmates were dreaming of future careers as doctors, actors, firefighters, teachers, I was imagining life in a mental institute. Much of this damage might have been avoided if my father, Walter, had done anything to intervene. I didn't know it at the time, but having long been a target of her deranged attacks himself, Walter knew full well how destructive she was. But he decided his best plan was to just go along with her, express no negative opinions or feelings towards her, try to appease and absorb her anger, and hope for the best. And when my brother and I came along, Walter tried to do to us what he'd done to himself, erase whatever parts of us displeased her, even our laughter. Just hearing us laughing in another room was enough to annoy the imposter, and Walter would dutifully silence us. Like many enablers of malignant individuals, he thought the path of least resistance was the path to peace. Sadly, by endlessly indulging her, he guaranteed himself a lifetime of conflict. As a young child, I didn't perceive any of these complex relationship dynamics. All I saw was that he backed her up, consistently and aggressively. Fortunately, his efforts to mold us in his groveling image didn't work, but they did leave us fully exposed to the imposter's explosions in our most vulnerable years. Generally speaking, the only times her assaults failed to hit their mark was when I simply couldn't comprehend what she was going on about. For example, I had no idea what she was referring to with her repeated charges of sexual preoccupation. Her imagination could reshape anything into something lurid. Innocent playtime with friends became scenes of depravity. Innocent drawings were declared pornographic. From the vile names she hissed and spat at me, I knew I was being accused of something terrible, but beyond that, I was clueless. Luckily, by the time I got a sense of what she was alluding to, I was also starting to realize she was seriously unhinged. The second process we enter after damage is discovery. This is the first of the corrective processes that set us back on the road to health. Here, we begin to understand we're being abused. For some, that understanding comes fully formed in a burst of insight. For others, like me, it's more gradual. We start to spot inconsistencies we haven't registered before. We begin to perceive the strangeness of familiar behaviors. During the discovery process, we might continue to take on damage, but we finally start to see the damage for what it is, and we need to recognize the problem before we can do something about it. It's a sad irony that often one of the biggest blocks to our discovery is us. Whatever malignant environment we find ourselves in, a family, a romantic relationship, an ideological group, we often get so invested in wishful, idealistic notions about the bad actors in our midst that we're unable to take in the evidence repeatedly slapping us in the face. In my first few years, through my interactions with the imposter, I'd built up an image of who she was, like putting together the pieces of a jigsaw. Only instead of assembling the pieces on their own terms and finding out what they created, I'd already formed an idea of the final image in my head, and I'd been putting the pieces together to match it. The image was love. It was a predictable mistake. In early childhood, aside from our innate predisposition to form trusting attachments with our primary caregivers, almost everything and everyone around us portrays parental love as some kind of universal constant. So that's what I looked for. When the qualities we seek in people don't exist, we often find ways to misinterpret their behavior to fit our preconceptions. When the pieces of the imposter jigsaw hadn't fit my preconception of parental love, I tried to force them into that shape. The imposter's casual bullying became justified acts of discipline. Her no-win mind games became legitimate moral tests. I made all the classic excuses we make for authority figures when we try to reconcile malevolent behavior with a benevolent image. For years, that bogus image kept me swallowing the poison and chasing redemption for non-existent failures and transgressions. It also kept me feeling guilty. There was never a time when I desired her company or missed her when she was gone. My aversion to her seemed to confirm her claims about my rotten nature. Children weren't supposed to feel this way about their parents. But around the age of 8, something prompted me to reassess my mangled jigsaw. I noticed how two-faced she was. Whenever we had visitors or went out in public, it was like she became another person. She was cheerful, open, warm, selfless, humble, incapable of anger, teetering on sainthood. The things that usually provoked her were suddenly okay. Mistakes and accidents were laughed off and forgiven. It was a relief when we had visitors, because peace was guaranteed for a while. The moment they left, the halo vanished. Often, she'd immediately start ranting about things they'd said or done that she'd taken as deliberate insults. She'd erupt with the same six words. "Who do they think they are?" and proceed to eviscerate their characters. Her targets included many close relatives and friends, and for years I felt a grubby burden of secrecy around them, having to pretend not to know the vitriol being spewed behind their backs. But it began to seem odd to me that she didn't confront them directly. She seemed to thrive on confrontations. She'd often lay into staff members in shops and restaurants over absolutely nothing. So why would she hold back with these supposedly insulting visitors? And why, the next time she saw them, did she act like they were best buddies? I didn't know it yet, but I was beginning to register her mask, the false face she used to navigate public life. The imposter's double-sided nature piqued my curiosity, and it would become the new foundational piece of her jigsaw. With that piece laid down, others would now fall into place as I quietly observed her. I began to see how stupendously judgmental she was, constantly hunting for flaws in people, especially other women. She might decide they had weak shoulders, or low ears, or a manly jaw. She'd get particularly fixated with any female who was popular with other members of the household. Two of my favorite childhood singers, Kate Bush and Debbie Harry, would spark furious insults and impersonations. Sometimes, when she couldn't find any flaws, she invented ones. With the actor Lindsay Wagner, who came to fame as the Bionic Woman, the imposter claimed she had unnaturally stubborn hair and that it had to be completely restyled every few minutes. Whenever she appeared on TV, from shot to shot, the imposter would shout, "Look, her hair's totally different now. Look, her hair's totally different now." I began to see how this obsessive fault-finding connected to another trait. The imposter was fiercely envious. Personal qualities that seemed to put other women ahead of her were often a source of huge resentment. It was disturbing to see how envy could reduce a grown-up to such infantile displays. And it was bizarre that she saw herself in competition with these talented, accomplished women. It pointed to another unwholesome trait. She was so vain. She would have probably thought this video was about her. She often admired old photos of herself and said people had told her she was an exceptional beauty, on a par with her Hollywood idol, Ava Gardner. When the American sitcom The Golden Girls began airing in the UK, she was mortified when people started telling her she looked like Bea Arthur. If you ever come across Ms. Arthur's earlier sitcom, Maud, the resemblance is striking. The imposter would sometimes call on me to reassure her there was no similarity. She'd snort with satisfaction when I told her she was nothing like Bea Arthur. Only what I secretly meant was that she had none of her doppelganger's humor or warmth. Her vanity reflected another quality. She was deeply delusional. This became very evident in her endless victory stories. Epic tales of triumph over people in everyday life, from close relatives to complete strangers. They were an odd mix of eye for an eye and turn the other cheek. In some stories, she'd recount how she got secret revenge for some perceived offense. In other stories, she'd boast about how she could have taken revenge, but instead took the higher moral ground. Both kinds of stories would end with the same punchline: "I showed them." And they had something else in common. Most of them never happened. I was usually present when these supposed incidents took place, and her accounts of them were often unrecognizable to me. For years, I put this down to memory problems on my part, but certain details would stand out in my mind, and I started checking them out with my brother. I began to see a pattern of distortion in the imposter's stories. She kept assigning malicious motives to completely innocent exchanges. Kind words became sarcasm. Offers of help became insinuations of stupidity. Many of the encounters that would become her victory stories actually began with her getting something wrong, like mistakenly jumping a queue. And most of the time, people corrected her very gently. But to her, the mildest corrections became scathing put-downs. She was intolerant of any criticism. Her actions were beyond reproach. Her opinions and preferences were objectively correct. As all these jigsaw pieces fell into position, two interrelated shifts started to take place. As her disconnection from reality became clearer, my doubts about my own mind began to recede. I became more sure of my memory, my senses, my judgment. Then, one day, a new piece of the jigsaw solidified everything. We were on a caravan holiday. On a drive out to a craft fair, I'd bought myself a cheap wooden flute. On the drive back, I started working out how to play one of my favorite songs, Eleanor Rigby, by the Beatles. After a while, the imposter barked at me to stop. I put the flute down. A few moments later, she spun round and bellowed, "I told you to stop!" Bewildered, I said, "I did stop." Then she told me to swear to her God that I was telling the truth. I knew what was coming. It was a familiar ritual. Sometimes, instead of just falsely accusing and punishing me, she liked to draw things out, commanding me to swear I was innocent of whatever malicious deed or motive she suspected me of. Of course, the verdict was already set. The moment I swore my innocence, she'd triumphantly declare, "You're going green." i.e., my guilt was literally turning my face green. My punishment would then be extra harsh because I'd failed to confess when I'd had the chance. For years, more than any other phrase, "you're going green" had made me feel like I was truly losing my mind. Being told I was physically expressing guilt for acts I had no knowledge of made my brain fuse. But sitting in the back of that car, the phrase had no effect. I knew the accusation was absurd. At first, I thought she was just deluded. But seeing her grin, I realized she knew what she was doing. And a major puzzle piece fell into place. Besides being delusional, she was cruel. She was playing a spiteful mind game just for the fun of it. When we got back to the caravan site, I was ordered straight to bed with no dinner. The imposter said I should thank her for letting me off so lightly because we were on holiday. Without a word, I went to bed. My mind was in overdrive. I recalled countless similar times when she'd convinced me I was guilty of what I now knew to be imaginary offences. And I recalled the brutal punishments I took for them. I could have reacted with anger or resentment, but what I felt was exhilaration. The pure Archimedean joy of discovery. All the swirling confusion I'd been born into had snapped into coherence. I wasn't mad or a monster. I'd been tricked into believing those things. There would be more grotesque puzzle pieces to come, but I could see the basic picture now. I also thought about Walter and how he'd always backed her up. At first, I assumed he was just like her, and the pair of them were in cahoots. But the next day, he went overboard, trying to be nice to me, offering me treats and trying to joke around. And it occurred to me that maybe he was trying to make up for what she'd done. Over the following weeks, I observed them together, and I had my second eureka moment. He backed her up, not because he was like her, or agreed with her, but because he was afraid of her. I began to see how he diminished himself around her, how the life drained out of him when she started her rants. He was on the imposter's minefield, just like me, my brother, and Calla. My first reaction to this revelation was to feel a swell of empathy for him. And for a brief time, I saw him and the imposter in a simplistic black and white way as the good parent and the bad parent, I imagined that if he had married someone else, he might have been a very different father. It's easy to get into a very tangled up relationship with the parent who enables the anti-parent. Viewing these enabling parents as fellow targets, we ignore their neglect. We excuse their complicity. When we erase their accountability, we can end up sliding back and forth between feeling protective towards them and being betrayed by them, hoping they'll come to their senses and take action, and being knocked flat with disappointment. It can be even more of a psychological seesaw than life with the anti-parent. Luckily, Walter's unwavering submission to the imposter didn't allow much hope. As he continued to indulge her cruelty and enforce it, my empathy faded fast. I realized it didn't matter what kind of father he might have been with another wife. It was his actions with this one that counted. If he'd fought to protect us and lost, I could have respected him. Instead, he chose to have his own children routinely, casually trampled, just to try, in vain, to keep her sweet. He seemed to be in complete denial of the damage being done to us. It was like we were stress toys that would magically bounce back into shape no matter how much pummeling we took. Walter's abandonment of his parental duty of care was something our relationship would never fully recover from. For a while, I saw them both as bad parents. Before long, I stopped thinking of them as parents altogether. That title didn't fit either of them. I filled the parent-shaped hole they left with other people, from inspiring teachers, kind neighbors, and other children's wonderful parents, to beloved characters in literature and TV. Like a magpie, I collected the parts of them that I knew to be good, and created an internal patchwork parent. From this rich, ever-expanding resource, I took my inspiration, my strength, and my discipline. And it would be an invaluable help as I moved into a new phase of interactions with the imposter. Having discovered what I was dealing with, I would now enter the next process in the path back to health, defense. I'd begin to take conscious, organized measures to fend off the poison. As an 8-year-old, there was little direct action I could take against the imposter. But I vowed to myself that when I was as big as Walter, she'd learn to behave herself around me. As it turned out, it didn't take anywhere near that long